My name is Ronald Goh. I'm one of the hematologists at Mayo Clinic, and I have clinical and research interests in histiocytosis or histiocytic disorders, including Erdheim-Chester disease, Langerhans cell histiocytosis, and Rosai-Dorfman disease.
I am Gaurav Goyal. I'm a fellow at Mayo Clinic in hematology oncology, just finishing up my training. My interests are in histiocytosis and lymphoid malignancies. So Erdheim-Chester disease is a rare blood disorder. Now it is actually included in the World Health Organization classification of cancers as blood cancers, but it's a slow-growing type of blood disease which involves various organs. It can act on any organ system of the body throughout the course of patient's disease.
And it present with various signs and symptoms, as mentioned earlier, can affect multiple organs. And the symptoms, unfortunately, and the signs are not specific for Erdheim-Chester disease. And therefore, it is common to be diagnosed late. It could be as long as 7, 8, or even 10 years after initial disease presentation. Some of the common presenting signs and symptoms include the following. Diabetes insipidus is one of the signs of Erdheim-Chester disease. So this is a condition wherein the pituitary gland, which is a gland in the brain that controls secretions of certain hormones. One of the hormones affected is called vasopressin, and this hormone allows our body to retain the fluid that we drink every day. And the lack of this hormone, if it's destroyed by Erdheim-Chester in the pituitary gland, can result in a lot of urination, frequent urination, and being thirsty all the time are initial signs and symptoms of diabetes insipidus. The diabetes insipidus is especially, it's not a common condition. However, it is not uncommon to have diabetes insipidus presenting 5 or even more than 10 years before the diagnosis of Erdheim-Chester disease, because diabetes insipidus can be due to other causes as well. Other signs and symptoms would include bone pains, and it's not really specific. Usually the pains involve the legs, the long bones of the legs, could be the arms, not common to be like in the spine, and because bone pains are commonly due to other conditions, it is not, ECD is not one of the initial diagnoses. However, imaging studies such as bone scan can show some signs that would be very suggestive or supportive of ECD. Skin findings can also be present. Usually it presents as yellowish cholesterol patches around the eyes. Could be in the other areas of the body as well. Kidney involvement is also common. Usually patients do not have symptoms, but if they do, it may be pain in the back or what we call the flank above the hip areas, and that's because the disease produces a lot of scar tissue wrapped around the kidneys. Rarely patients can present with kidney obstruction. Another sign is neurologic signs or symptoms, headaches, problems with balance, problem with coordination of the body, and this is due to involvement of the disease in the back of the brain we call the cerebellum. Yeah. Other organs involved, not as common, would include the heart, and so patients can present with inflammation around the heart, chest pains, fluid around the heart, and also inflammation of the lungs, usually fluid around the lungs, and thickening of the covering of the lungs, and patients can present with shortness of breath. So these are more serious symptoms and signs. Unfortunately, again, they're not specific to Erdheim-Chester disease. Frequently, the doctors will think of the more common diagnosis other than Erdheim-Chester disease.
Yeah, I think you pretty much covered all of them. I think other hormones can be affected as well. They are non-specific symptoms. You could have, fatigue. So not all hormonal changes can be found on a CT scan or such. So, blood tests and so forth can help tease them out for the patients with ECD. But like Dr. Goh said, that there is no one set of symptoms that we can right away point toward ECD. So it's more the constellation of symptoms and signs together that should make someone raise suspicion for the diagnosis.